The Lord be with you. Good morning. We're glad that you're here. We're glad for the ones of you watching this online. Let me remind you that it's communion today, so go find your elements and get them ready. If you don't have your elements, they're outside in the narthex. We have an announcement from Bill Long about the peacemaking offering.
Good morning. Bob Nell asked me to talk to you a little bit about the peacemaking offering. You have it in your bulletin, and on the back it says, our peace and global witness offering enables the church to promote the peace of Christ by addressing systems of injustice in our communities and across the world. What I want to talk to you about is in our community. We give 25% of the peacemaking offerings we take up to a local organization, and he asked me to talk today because it's this organization this week will be Outright Youth of Catawba County, of Catawba Valley. And for you who don't know, about 11 years ago in my practice, I had three teenagers, two 14-year-old boys and a 16-year-old boy, who were having great problems because they had decided that they were gay. One of them told his mother he thought he was gay. She said, I'm a Christian, you're going to hell. The other one came into the hospital with pseudo seizures because of the traumas he'd had. And the other one, after several years of a stepmother who berated him every day, got into a lot of complications and health problems. There was no place in Catawba County. So a number of us, I talked to several people, and a number of us started something called Outright Youth of Catawba Valley. Hopefully not only to help people, help these teenagers cope, but also to give them a safe space and a place where they could be themselves. And at this point, Outright Youth has grown. At one of our last in-person meetings, we had 23 kids. We get a lot from Caldwell County and Lincoln County as well. So I encourage you, if you want more information, go to Catawba Valley, Outright Youth, CatawbaValley.org. I think the website is OutrightYouthCV.org. And I appreciate your letting me talk to you, and I would appreciate your funds. Thank you.
Let's prepare ourselves for worship.
Thank you.
I invite those of you who are able to stand, and let us all join in the call to worship and the prayer. I will sing a song of thanksgiving, O Lord, and tell of all your wondrous deeds.
O Lord, I love the house in which you dwell, and the place where your glory abides.
But as for me, I walk in my integrity. Redeem me and be gracious to me.
My foot stands on level ground. In the great congregation, I will bless the Lord.
Let us worship God and let us pray together. God of the ages, whose care for your children spans generations, we praise and adore you. We hear how you led Israel through their wanderings and brought them safely to the promised land. We are taught that Christ calls us to enter your covenant, that you open your kingdom to all who believe in him. We take part in your graciousness and live by your mercy. Hear our worship of you as we confess our faith anew.
Amen.
The mark. And so let us be honest and confess our sins. O God of creation,
You entrust us as stewards. We confess our abuse of what you place in our care. We foul the water by deliberate disposal. The air is polluted with emissions we create. We burn the forest through carelessness. The oceans are poisoned with toxins. Forgive our neglect of nature's delicate balance and have mercy upon us as we renew our commitment to the created order.
Amen. Jesus Christ is the one through whom and for whom all things were created. And in Jesus Christ, our sins are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Amen. Seated.
Join hands then, brothers of the faith, throughout the whole wide earth.
Somebody say, man, they have got the patience of Job. Now, there's nobody else I know that quite has the patience than Job does. Because he started off winning the game of life. He had children, lots of children. He had land. He had livestock. He had all those things that said that he was winning at the game of life. Then all of a sudden, he begins to lose every single one of those. He lost his livestock. He lost his children, his land, his home. And then to top it all off, he gets all these itchy red bumps all over him. And that's never fun. But the thing about this is that during this story, sometimes when bad things happen, sometimes we tend to blame God or we're angry at God, and it's hard. But one thing Job did is he never blamed God. He constantly had faith in God. He never lost it. Even though there was people telling him, why are you still following God? All this bad stuff is happening to you. It's not fair. Why are you still following God? But even with the itchy bumps and all, he still followed God because he knew that if he kept his faith in God, God wasn't gonna lose faith in him either. And that's the important thing to remember. Even as we go through another crazy year with everything going on, we are never alone. God is always with us. So when bad things happen, we should try to lean on God and know that he is always there. And he is never going to lose faith in us because he loves us so much that he sent his son. Even though we were sinners and even though we mess up all the time, he sent his son to come and die for our sins because he loves us and he believes in us that much. So remember, when bad things happen, try your best to have patience like Job and never lose faith in God because he's never going to lose faith in you. All right? So if you are going to go down for a blast, Miss Robin is in the back. She'll meet you back there. And we will say our prayer. So repeat after me. Dear God, thank you for never losing faith in us. Help us to always believe in you. Amen.
These next couple of weeks are one of the only times that the book of Job appears in the lectionary. And being braver than I am smart, I said, well, we'll do it, but we'll do it all in 1 week in a fairly short sermon. So we'll read chapter 1, verse 1, and then we'll read the first 10 verses of chapter 2. There was once a man in the land of Uz whose name was Job. The man was blameless and upright, one who feared God and turned away from evil. Now one day the heavenly beings came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan also came among them to present himself before the Lord. And the Lord said to Satan, "Where have you come from?" And Satan answered the Lord, "From going to and fro on the earth and from walking up and down on it." And the Lord said to Satan, "Have you considered my servant Job? There is no one like him on the earth, a blameless and upright man who fears God and turns away from evil. He still persists in his integrity, although you incited me against him to destroy him for no reason." Then Satan answered the Lord, "Skin for skin, all that people have they will give to save their lives. But stretch out your hand now and touch his bone and his flesh, and he will curse you to your face." The Lord said to Satan, "Very well, he is in your power, only spare his life." So Satan went out from the presence of the Lord and inflicted loathsome sores on Job, from the sole of his foot to the crown of his head. Job took a potsherd with which to scrape himself and sat among the ashes. Then his wife said to him, "Do you still persist in your integrity? Curse God and die." But he said to her, "You speak as any foolish woman would speak. Shall we receive the good at the hand of God and not receive the bad?" In all this, Job did not sin with his lips. The word of the Lord. In the history of humankind, there are a great many big, large, incomprehensible books devoted to explaining how evil could exist and how it can coexist with any idea of a good and loving God. The Bible simply starts out with, there one time was this man. There was a man. And the story of this man teaches us many things. We learn, first of all, that there's evil. We see that there's evil and that it has freedom to afflict us. Now, in the story, Satan appears as kind of the accuser, the prosecuting attorney, who says to God, "Let's see what happens if you let him suffer. See if he'll remain faithful in that case." Now, we might not care for the way that this shows God and Satan cooperating. We have a very different understanding of these things, but we see, first of all, that evil is real. And we see the extent to which evil is under the control of God. God is in control, and Satan has to have God's permission to do anything. We might not see him that way, but that's how the ancient Bible writers understood him. God is ultimately in control. No matter what happens to us in the short term, God is the final judge. Another thing we see is that when evil comes, we have a choice whether to remain hopeful and faithful or to give up in despair. How will faith respond to evil? I like to quote Simone Weil, who said once that it's not surprising that diseases and criminals attack us and kill us because there are germs and bad people who do those things. It is surprising, she said, that these things have the power to kill the soul, to take away our faith. So today we hear the questions. We hear the ones that Job asks, and the ones that Job's friends ask, and the ones that we might ask. Job keeps saying, "Why me?" Over and over we hear that in Job. We hear it from people who are in great pain and suffering, who've suffered a great loss, who can't believe how bad life can be. I used to work with a pastor who laughed at that and said, "You know, no one ever says, 'Why me?' when they hit the lottery and win $1 million. But they should. We somehow expect, we assume that life is going to treat us fairly and even well. So when anything bad happens, our first question is, what have I done to deserve this? Why me? Now, the bulk of the book of Job is the discussions that he has with his three friends. One of them was called Bildad the Shuhite. So you remember the question is, who's the shortest man in the Bible? Bildad the Shuhite. These friends assume that Job has sinned. He must have sinned. Bad things come as a consequence of sin. So you must have sinned. We still hear that thinking today. You know, when Hurricane Katrina hit New Orleans, there were pastors quick to rush to the TV and say, "Well, the hurricane hit New Orleans because of all the evil and sin that takes place in that city." Till a blogger pointed out that, well, if God sent the hurricane to New Orleans as a result of sin, God's not a very good bowler, because the hurricane didn't hit the French Quarter. It veered off and into the Ninth Ward, where the poor people lived. So God's aim isn't very good. Evil doesn't come as a consequence of sin. Now, sin has consequences. There are things that we do that lead to evil consequences for us, but there's no direct correlation between what we do and what happens later. Job keeps telling his friends that he's righteous. He has not sinned. He doesn't deserve any of this. So a fourth friend comes up, and he says, Job, you're being presumptuous and self-righteous. It's arrogant to say you haven't sinned, to say that you don't deserve anything bad in your life. And even then, Job finds it hard to agree. Is proclaiming humility actually a sin? Finally, God answers him. In about chapter 38, God says, gird up your loins, man, stand up. Answer this question, where were you when I created the world? And God goes on like that for a couple chapters. Where were you when I made the great Leviathan? Where were you when I did all these things? Who are you? And how dare you hold me, the Lord God, your creator, to account for what happens? Who are you to question what I do? And Job's response is in humility to agree that he has no right to question God. He submits to God's will even in the depths of his affliction. And eventually, and this is not guaranteed to Job or anyone else, but eventually he gets it all back and he prospers again. So we have these questions. We're allowed to ask questions. We're allowed to ask these deep questions, but we're not allowed to ask them as though we could put God on the stand and force his testimony. We're not independent of God, able to demand an accounting from him. We're always his creatures, and even when we protest, we ask these questions, we remain his creatures that he loves. And not even the power of death itself can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. So, there's a lot of anxiety out there these days. There's great financial uncertainty. You know, how long will the market continue to sail? People are afraid that they'll lose their job, afraid that everything will change and they won't have a job, afraid that they won't have any money. How will we survive? How will we pay our bills? How will we make a pledge to the church? Then there's the pandemic. You know, it was bad, but it seems like it's over, right? Everyone is almost back to the normal round of daily life. Schools are open. Restaurants are open. You have to wear a mask. You should get a vaccine and a booster shot. You could still get COVID, even if you take all these precautions. You could get a breakthrough case. You could still die. It's very much still with us, and it scares us. Then there's this war on terror. We've been fighting it openly for 20 years, and we all know people have been overseas. And now we've left Afghanistan, but we're still afraid. What if the terrorists rise again? What if they reestablish themselves? What if they attack us again? What if it escalates? You know, bad things happen in the world. There are 1,000 things you can be afraid of. COVID, diseases in your food, even the air that you breathe could be poisonous. There are 1,000 things to fear. And we ask God these questions. Hey, God, why don't you make it all go away? Save us. And notice what God does and does not do. God does not wave his arms, say some magic words, and make it all go away. He doesn't order some angel to come down and, you know, take names and fix it. He doesn't do that, and it's not because he doesn't care. He does care. But it's the way he set up the world to operate, and we have freedom in the world. We have a role to play, and we make choices. We have to live with the consequences of those choices at times. Somewhere along the line, about 40-odd years ago, it occurred to me that with my chemistry grades, I was never going to get into medical school. I don't know how much chemistry, organic chemistry, you doctors use on a day-to-day basis, but, you know, you had to know it to get in. And so I made the decision to change my major and go to the philosophy department. So I will not be operating on you today. And that's a good thing. I'll pray for the ones who do operate on you. We have these choices, and we have to live with the consequences. And even some things that we don't choose come our way in this fallen world, and we have to live with those things too. God does not wave his arms and fix it, but he lifts up his arms and they're nailed to a cross. He comes into the world in the person of Jesus, and he gets killed for his trouble. God knows all about this world and its arbitrary evils. He knows all about the bad things that come. He knows all about the bad things that people do. He knows all of that, and he cares. He cares for each of us. He cares for Job. He cares for the countless others who've lived and suffered in this world. And God cares. And far from leaving us simply to die, he comes and gathers us to him, suffering with us and for us. In Jesus Christ, God cares. That's what he does. And God will rule over all things and eventually put everything right. And so we can put our trust in Jesus Christ, in humility and love. And there we will find, despite what comes, peace. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Lord, when my
let us together say the creed that has been handed down to us by all the saints and that we share with the church everywhere as we gather today on World Communion, the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Seated. And we gather here in our pandemic-affected way around Christ's table. He invites us here. It's not a Presbyterian table. He invites all of us, any of us who seek to know him better, to come and receive his body and blood. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right and our duty and highest joy that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy God, Father Almighty, everlasting Lord. You created the heavens and the earth and all that is in them. You made us in your own image, and in countless ways you show us your mercy. And above all, we praise you for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus, the true Passover Lamb who takes away the sins of the world. By his death, he destroyed death, and by his rising, brought us eternal life. And therefore, with angels and archangels and the whole company of heaven, we worship and adore your glorious name, praising you with the universal church and the heavenly choir. Are yours, Holy God, for in your great mercy you gave us your only Son, Jesus. He took our human nature and suffered death on the cross for our redemption. There he made a perfect sacrifice for the sins of the whole world. And we praise you that before he suffered and died, he gave us this holy sacrament and commanded us to continue it as a lasting memorial of his death and sacrifice until he comes again. And so, remembering his incarnation and holy life, his death and glorious resurrection, his ascension and continual intercession for us, and awaiting his coming again in power and great glory, We claim his eternal sacrifice and celebrate with these your gifts the memorial your Son commanded us to make. For great is the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
And so, merciful God, by your Spirit, bless and make holy both us and these your gifts of bread and wine, that the bread we break may be a communion in the body of Christ, and the cup we bless may be a communion in the blood of Christ. Here we offer ourselves to you to be a living sacrifice. Accept this our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, as in communion with all the faithful in heaven and on earth, we ask you to fulfill in us and in all creation the purpose of your redeeming love. Hear us as we pray the prayer that Jesus taught.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
On the night before he died, the Lord Jesus took bread. When he'd given thanks to God, he blessed it and he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And after supper, he took the cup in the same way. And he said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. All of you drink it. And as often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim his death until he comes again. And so let us partake." Let us pray together. Now, Lord, you let your servant go in peace. Your word has been fulfilled. My own eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the sight of every people, a light to reveal you to the nations and the glory of your people Israel. Amen.
Thank you.
So take his presence with you and share it with the world. Become the body of Christ for those out there who are hungry in body and in soul. And as you go, may all the blessing of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you now and forever. Alleluia.
Amen. Amen.
See ya humble kookanani quinkos. 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 We are singing for the Lord is our light. We are singing for the Lord is our light. We are singing for the Lord is our light. We are singing for the Lord is our light. We are singing, singing, we are singing, singing, we are singing for the Lord is, for the Lord is our light. We are singing, singing, we are singing, singing, we are singing for the Lord is our light. The Lord is the strength of our lives. Of whom shall we be afraid? No foes destroy, the Lord will be our light. We are singing for the Lord is our light. We are singing for the Lord is our light. We are singing for the Lord is our light. We are singing for the Lord is our light. We are singing, singing, we are singing, singing, we are singing for the Lord is, for the Lord is our light. We are singing, singing, we are singing, singing, we are singing for the Lord is our light.
Singing, singing, we are singing.
strength of the Lord. God's love is ever sure. We shout that the world may hear. We sing a joyful song. See a hummock of Kananiquin coast. 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 We are singing, singing, we are singing. Singing, we are singing, for the Lord is our, the Lord is our light. We are singing, singing, we are singing. Singing, we are singing, for the Lord is our light. We are singing, singing, we are singing. Singing, we are singing, for the Lord is our, the Lord is our light. We are singing, singing, we are singing. Singing, we are singing, for the Lord is our light.